course requirements, then 2 years in China, then 5 years back in Stanford, during which time I wrote this travel book about hitchhiking across Tibet back to India, and also the Golden Gate. So it took me 11 years not to get my PhD, which is something of a record. I'm afraid I used that joke before, and it always causes slightly rueful laugh. So I'm what they call an ABD, an all but dissertation. But one thing I did learn from being an economist was this, that there are things called opportunity costs. And if, for example, I told the muse, look, I have to finish my dissertation, come back to the Golden Gate a year or two later, he or she, whatever the form the muse takes, will have gone away, and it will serve me right. So one of this is not to think whether something is worth doing, but whether there's something better that you could do, even if it's riskier. And the other piece of advice I have is this. After I finished writing The Golden Gate, I had just about enough by way of an advance to take myself and my books back to Delhi without a thesis, of course. And I looked to my parents and I said to them, look, do you think I want to write another novel? I want this to be set in India. I have no idea exactly what it's going to be. It'll be about 200-300 pages at the most. And it'll take me a year or two. So do you think you could just, could I come home? So my mother, who actually is quite literary and I love literature, she said, no, I don't think we should, she said to my father, I don't think we should do that. No, let the boy take care of himself. What will happen when we are gone? He's got 2 good degrees in economics from 2 universities. Let him get a job, then he can indulge his hobby later. And my father said, well, he hasn't cost us much, you know, he's got his scholarships and things. What's the harm? So I went in my 30s to sponge off my parents in Delhi. They had a nice large house. My mother was a judge, so she got a kind of official house. Now, of course, we live in a smaller place. But at the top floor was empty. But all the children came back. My brother, who was a bit of a kind of Buddhist persona, and in fact, he's a teacher now. My sister, Radhana, who was studying filmmaking, was a filmmaker. And myself, who was supposed to be earning money, but probably earning minus ₹7,000 a month. But we were all living in our parents' house as sort of adults. And our driver was really shocked, you know. He was asked by a colleague, what do these people do? And he said, hey, kya kahe? I wish anybody said that. But in any case, so this is what I advise you to do. Robert Frost said, home is the place where if you have to go, they have to let you in. Shastas asked me to read a Dufu poem. This was written in the, as I said, the 8th century. And Dufu was a civil servant, actually. No, aspired to be a civil servant. He wanted to serve not just the emperor, but the people, in a sense. It was part of the Confucian philosophy. And it took it very hard, because he kept failing these civil service exams. I got it, because he is one of the supreme poets. Although at that time he was not much recognized as a great poet. At the end of his life, he's wandering down the Yangtze to go back home after a terrible rebellion which shattered the empire. He was separated from his family. One of his young children died of starvation because of the destruction of supplies. And of course, he was not to know that many generations after his death, and to this very day, he's recognized probably as China's greatest poet. Very moving, slightly self-deprecating, wonderful wordsmith at the same time. This is a very feeble attempt to translate an 8-line poem that he wrote. It's called Thoughts While Travelling at Night. And the great river that he refers to is the Yangtze. Light breeze on the fine grass. I stand alone at the mast. Stars lean on the vast wild plain. Moon bobs in the great river's spate. Letters have got no fame. Office too old to obtain. Drifting, what am I like? A gull between earth and sky. The second is by Garlet, 2 years after the mutiny. And it's not a translation of a poem of his. I have translated some of the poetry from Fairs and others. But in this case, it's a translation, really, or a versification, you might say, of a letter of his. Now, he was a wonderful letter writer. Some people say, that, I mean, really, it's hard to choose. Even if he were not known as a great poet, his letters itself are so lively, so animated, so humane, so full of interest, that he would be one of the greatest prose writers of the language. He's writing to a friend, Yusuf Mirza. Dear Yusuf Mirza, none but God can know my plight. Men have gone mad from cares far less than those I fight. But grief and cares for what, you ask? What do I claim? For death, for parting, for my livelihood, my name. Whose debts? I leave aside the stricken Mughal court, in Delhi proper, not the inauspicious fort. Your uncle, Ashur Bey, and me, Nasir al-Din, my sister's grandson too, a mere child of 19. Mustafa Khan, his sons, the blood flows to my pen, the names go on. Oh God, what can replace such men? Those of my friends who live, like Virat and Majnun, condemned to roam the world, may God preserve them too. My brother died insane, his children and his wife, stranded in Jaipur, eke their pittance of a life. The children of high lords go begging in the street. My household, God knows how, finds just enough to eat. Nor is my time my own. I have grown old. How can I bear this load? I am no giant, but a man. I leave my sick bed, try to sit an hour or two, to write, to plan, to think. But there's too much to do. As for sustaining wine, my cash won't spill that far, still less to buy a gift if called to the darbar. They used to call me once, will they do so again? I have neither helped nor harmed the Englishmen. I'm sending you an ode about my life, which night and day for 2 long months I've sweated blood to write. Say if you think my skill has cheated fortune's knife, even if my heart lacks fire, white fire, even life. In my old eulogy for Amjad Ali's name, I've spotted Vajidin, but God has done the same. Such verse and praise of kings, just notch it down a peg. I wrote it not to show my prowess, but to beg. More news. That gentle boy, Shivji Ram's son and pride, fell ill, lay 2 days thus, and on the 3rd day died. His father is distraught with grief, and for my part, I have lost 2 more friends, one dead, one sick at heart. Another 20 months, and I too will be dust. My body to Rampur, my soul to light, I trust. What grief, joy, praise, or shame afflict me in this spell, I will find strength to face. Goodbye. May all be well.